All right, so we're live. I'm going to see if I can connect and share the video with some people. And I'm going to give a little bit of time so that others may join us. There we go. Just giving a little bit of time to some people. I think I'm getting, I'm trying to share the post with some people, because I know that this might be a little, not shocking, but the enemy has been working really hard to prevent his people from listening to this message. So I'm grateful that the Lord has allowed me, or has allowed this medium to be able to talk to the people of God. And so I'm just going to give a little bit of, about 30 more seconds before we start. And again, I believe this is important for the people of God to hear this particular message. Not because it comes from me, because it comes from the Lord. I'm just a messenger. I'm just a tool that the Lord is going to use, perhaps to change something in your life that you have never dealt with before. And so I'm going to try to stay on point. I gave myself a particular amount of time, and I'm going to respect that from each and every one of you. So today's word is going to come from the book of Genesis. But let me tell you first what happened. This morning I was praying, and I was spending time with the Lord about 3 o'clock in the morning. And I'm not telling you this because I'm boasting. And just this, the Lord is leading me in a new direction with Acts Fellowship. And I was so grateful. And so I'm spending time with the Lord. And just like that, actually before that, I had a dream. And the Lord took me to a place where I was before. And he showed me something that I've never seen before. And the Lord showed me how my perspective was not allowing his purpose, his will, if you will, to be exercised in my life. And so I asked, Father, how do I teach this to the flock? And, you know, some of you may know this. I was commissioned by the Lord to be a pastor. And what a great honor. But Father God spoke to me, and that's what woke me up and said, you must show them. And it was shocking to me. So let me go to the Word of God. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. Then the Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living soul, a living creature. Father, thank you for your oracles that have been placed in our heart by your Son. For in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. Lord, thank you for sending him so that we may pursue him, so that we may become like him. As the firstborn, many brethren, let us be the second and the third born so that we can show you glory in everything that we do. Holy Spirit, I pray that you touch the life of the people watching the broadcast and the lives that are coming to our fellowship, for that we are to glorify you in spirit and in truth. And we pray this in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen. I just read a passage of scripture that most of you perhaps read thousands of times, Genesis. And my perspective had to change. So let me tell you what the dream was. I dreamt that I was driving when I was in law school from one location to another one. You see, when I went to law school in Houston, I parked myself. I got an apartment approximately 5 miles away from where I was going to go to school. Why? Because I thought to myself, I need to be in this affluential neighborhood because, after all, I'm going to be an attorney. And I was putting myself in that spot. There was a closer location, less expensive, but it was not so glamorous. So I chose not to do that. And the Holy Spirit of God took me to that place and showed me. And by the way, it took me an hour and a half every day driving 5 miles
to get from where I was supposed to be to where I needed to be, school. An hour and a half for 5 miles, that's crazy. That's Houston traffic, by the way. But the Holy Spirit showed me that's exactly what many believers do. You see, we choose to be in a particular place, and we should be in another place where the Holy Spirit can take you and use you, but we choose not to because of fame, fortune, location, position, and we forget what the Holy Spirit is telling us, so we place ourselves in a different location. You see, the perspective has to change. So I do what I always do when the Lord gives me a word. I Google it. I Google the perspective. What does it mean? So I went to check perspective, and there are two nouns that are used. The first is the art of drawing solid objects on a two-dimensional surface so as to give the right impressions of their height, width, depth, and position in relation to each other when viewed from a particular point. The second noun, a particular attitude towards or a way regarding something, a point of view. You see, this teaching is about the perspective in a spiritual way. If you're like me, it is taking me some time to realize that I need to see things spiritually, not in the flesh. And so I'm going to share with you what the Word says about that particular aspect, because many of us don't realize that there's a spiritual aspect of us and there's a flesh or body aspect, because we're so caught up in the middle. And that middle is called the soul. And so let's go back to the Word of God, but let's analyze it, how it's supposed to apply to us in a different perspective. Then the Lord God formed the man. You see, before chapter 2 in Genesis 1, we read that God said, and it was so. God spoke, and it was so. Chapter 2, now, God formed. Imagine yourself being formed by God. There's a reason why he chose to form you. Now you have a body. Here you have the image of God, not in that sense, but it's in a spiritual sense. In the image of God, we were created. But we choose all the time to stay away from God. Sin did this to us. But let's go back to what it says. Then the Lord God formed the man of the dust of the ground. Many people think that dust simplifies something that is weak. And many people ask, why didn't God use wood or iron? And it's imperative that we know that it's because we have to depend on our Creator in order for us to become what we don't even see. Our Creator is, God is so awesome. And so he formed you. He's forming you now. You have a body. And then it goes to say, and breath into his nostril, the breath of life. That is your spirit. Now you have a body and you have a spirit. But what is unique about this and the perspective that we have to see is that combination creates something miraculous, a soul. And your soul is your will, mind, and emotions. And that soul is what drives people to a particular direction. You see, my soul was driving me away from the Spirit of God, and that's what it took me so long from being a mature believer or a new believer to a mature believer. My soul kept me from it. And listen to what I read not too long ago. Apostle Macklin showed me this, and I was like, wow, this is amazing. Look what this man of God, by the way, Watchman Nee, wrote in 1928. He says, if a man's soul wills to obey God, it will allow the spirit to rule over the man as ordered by God. Oh my Lord. So all my life, my perspective has been wrong. Because I'm going to church, I feel good, I preach the gospel. But never mind that I must submit my soul so that the Holy Spirit can just guide me. And instead of, by the way, spirit, body, instead of going towards the body, fleshy, go to the spirit. But it is my soul, the medium that is used to take that. If you don't submit your soul to God, it's never going to happen, my friends. Now, let's see what the Word of God says. By the way, if you never heard about the firstborn, when I first heard about it, I was blown away. But it's in the Word of God. It's Romans 8:28. And it refers to Christ as the firstborn of many brethren. You and I are the second, the third, the fourth born. And we must imitate Christ. But we can only do that if we have the right perspective. And that is a heavenly perspective, a spiritual perspective, not a fleshy perspective like a lot of us may have had. And so here at Acts Fellowship, that's our purpose in life. It's not only to snatch souls away from the enemy, but to bring an application of what Pentecost was to the fellowship. You know, by the way, happy Pentecost to the people watching. I was reading my Facebook post, my Facebook thread, and many of them, happy Pentecost, the power of the Holy Spirit. And I've gone to the churches and it's like, wow. And I'm not here criticizing. I'm not. I'm just, the Lord commissioned this fellowship for something different. And it's the power of the Holy Spirit. But you have to have the application in order for you to learn it, to understand it. There's a process of sanctification. And if you don't know that, if you've never heard of that, how can you become it? You know, many people go to church. Well, how can you go to something that you are supposed to be? You have to learn to become that church. Now, the process of sanctification requires all three aspects to be sanctified. We don't hear this at places. Look, the Word of God says, 1 Thessalonians 5:23, the sanctification of the spirit, your soul, and your body. Read it. I didn't come up with this. But many of us think that it's only, I'm soulsy, I feel it this way, and I'm just, and we forget to deny ourselves on a daily basis so that the Spirit of God can come. And now, you see, you have free will. You have to understand that. The Holy Spirit of God is not going to come and just take over and just do whatever. He doesn't do that. You have to allow it. You have to say, Holy Spirit, I surrender. Unless you surrender, this spiritual walk perspective is not going to happen. It will never happen because the flesh and the spirit are against each other. And so now listen to what Watchman Nee said. And again, this blows my mind. I'm going to rephrase it. But this is what he said. The spirit can seduce the body through the medium of the soul so that it will obey God. Likewise, the body through the soul can draw the spirit into loving the world. My God, that's what I have been all of these years. And I'm not glorifying my past. I'm just changing my perspective. For so long, I was a Christian, check the box. But I was just, you know, like Apostle Macklin said, how can you preach or how can you be full of the spirit at a church and go home and beat up your wife or watch porn? How is that possible? No spirit. The perspective has to change, people. And that's why Acts Fellowship was created, to change that perspective so that we can learn to live in the spirit, by the spirit, controlled by the spirit. Everything that we do is through the spirit. The apostle asked the prophets and the pastors, and we listen to the spirit. We don't do our own thing. It feels good. Absolutely not. Now, let me go back and say this in relation to what Mr. Need just said. I'm going to rephrase it. The spirit can subdue the body only through the soul so that it will obey God. Listen to this. The spirit can subdue the body. Spirit, body. Through the soul, which is the middle, that's what controls it, so that it may obey God. Let's see what subdue means. I went in again. I Googled it. Subdue is to control. Oh my God, we have control whether I become spiritual or I stay soulsy. I have control. God gave me that free will, but I must choose. I was having coffee with Apostle and the prophets, and we were talking about this, and he put his glasses glasses. He says, you know, I could give you these glasses or you want, but you have the choice to pick or not. That is exactly what God has done to us. He's given us the Holy Spirit. He's given us the wonders. He's given us all of these miracles. We must choose to pick and select and carry on that so that we can be in the Spirit, or we can be saucy all day long and feeling good, and it's about love and it's about grace and all these wonderful things. And I'm losing members, not members, but viewers. And I understand this is not a very popular message, but you know, when the Holy Spirit tells you to do something, you must obey. So think about this. Jonah was given a direction. Jonah's, the word of God says, the word of the Lord said, arise and go to Nineveh. Arise. And Jonah, being the prophet that he was, he arose. But look what it says. But Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish. He went away. How many times have you done that in your life? That the God of the universe is asking you to do something and you're not doing it. You're going the opposite direction. You see, you have to change that perspective. When you look at God as who, what he is, there is no way that you can say, you know what, no, I'm going to Tevesh. You're going to go for whatever the Lord tells you to do. My brothers, I'm so excited that I can share the oracles of God. But unless you yourself decide that, you know, this soul business, I need to control it, subdue it, so that the spirit can control the body. Most of us are doing it the opposite. We allow the body to subdue the spirit, and it happens through the soul. Why? Oh, because we feel good. Oh, we go to church, we're feeling good. Oh yeah, grace is so wonderful. But we're forgetting that we are supposed to deny ourselves, that we are supposed to become Christ. We're supposed to imitate him. Was Christ in the flesh? You know, he received the Holy Spirit and he was pushed by the Holy Spirit. Are you being pushed by the Holy Spirit? Can God trust you with his message? Take it to Nineveh. Or are you going to say, no, never mind, I'm going the other direction? My brothers, change your perspective and help us change people's eternal zip code. It is about time that the church stands for what is right. Not what it feels good, but what is right. What is right is to live according to the scriptures. Live in the spirit. Performing the miracles that God wanted us to do. Seeing wonders. Having people live in the Acts, first century Pentecost. I ask you, if you went to church today, did you witness the Pentecost? Did you witness the miracles? Were you at awe of what you saw? Or were you just impressed by the performance? Were you impressed by the preaching, but no application in your life? You still go home and you still feeling those feelings that you want to go and watch porn, and you want to go and beat up your wife, and you want to go and continue to speak that garbage. You're watching the garbage of this world. This wedding, royal wedding, people are talking more about the wedding. They're talking about Christ. What is going on, people? Arise, says the Lord. He asked Isaiah, who can I send? Here I am, Lord. Send me. You must change your spiritual perspective in order for you to mature and grow so that Christ can give you those wonderful, the miracles and the wonders that you are waiting for. It's not going to happen unless you change your spiritual perspective. Abba Father gave us a wonderful gift, and it's called free will. But you can either use it to go spiritually or stay fleshly. You see, for so many years, I chose to be in the flesh. And yet, I was in the choir, I was preaching, I was in seminary school, and it wasn't until I submitted myself to the Holy Spirit and subdue. The Spirit has to subdue the body in order for it to manifest in a spiritual way. And that's where the different perspective comes from. You know, like Apostle Macklin, sometimes he runs out of time. And I know that there's some people here. I feel so privileged to be teaching about the oracles of God. But more importantly, I am in awe that the God of the universe formed me. See, he took time for me to become me. And he created only one, by the way. So you are one. There's no other one like you. Don't let the world tell you that you are this. No, no. You are who Christ says that you are. You are nothing that the world tells you. The flesh is going to, they're going to tell you all this. You are who Christ says that you are. You are, he took time to form you. Then he breathed the breath of life and the wonderful chemistry of God. Boom, you became a living soul. Now that living soul can control you, take you either in the narrow gate, which is the spirit, or the wide gate. You heard that song and you heard the scripture. A spiritual person is judged by no one, but in turn judges everything. If you don't understand what that means, I urge you to read 1 Corinthians 2:15. And it's about time that we choose to become the spiritual being that we are created to be in that fellowship with God, in a communion with God, so that when you can go to the throne and pray, you don't have to ask people. I cannot understand why so many people keep asking the same thing over and over. Will you please pray for me? Will you please pray for me? When we have that power, Christ says you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. He didn't say, well, you receive the ability to call somebody else. You. God formed you. God gave you the Spirit. Use it for His glory. Father God, I pray that this word penetrates, like your word says, the soul and the mind of the people listening to it. Father, may they become, like Christ says, like you and I, one. Father, I pray that prayer that Jesus prayed so many years ago continue to be a fact in our life so that we may glorify you in everything that we do. Jesus, thank you. We love you. Oh, Lord, thank you for sending Holy Spirit, a comforter, to allow us to see you and have that communion. We praise you, Lord. Oh, it is in your glorious name we pray. My brothers, sisters, again, I'm just delighted. We meet on Thursdays at 6:30, Acts Fellowship. What the Lord is doing is amazing. I'm just so blown by it. Come by it, check us out. And I promise we're not gonna spook you, but you are going to see miracles, and you're gonna hear prophecies, and you're gonna see people's being healed and delivered. But the most important thing, they're gonna stay delivered, because we teach them. Our apostle is very clear that we don't only stay free. We deal with the soul, and with the word of God. God bless you. I love y'all. And until next time, you take care. Again, happy Pentecost.